Hello everyone and welcome back to season 2 of Walk with Midday. Like the previous episode that we brought to you all the way from Ballad Estate, this heritage walk is also going to be shot on video without you readers to join us. However, we promise you the best seat in the house. That's because we've got an all-access ticket into one of Bikla's best kept secrets. This is going to be a special walk. Now, back in the early 1800s, it must have been a great time to be a resident of Bikla. Wide roads, palatial mansions, the swish Bikla Club, and even a race course. Bikla was one of the most developed neighborhoods outside of the fort. Now, the reason why Bikla shot into prominence was because the governor of Bombay decided to move outside the confines of the fort and actually build a country home in Parel, which is not so far from here. Soon after the governor decided on this, you had Bombay's rich and famous who also followed suit. The most notable name that comes to mind is Sir David Sassoon, the respected Jewish businessman and philanthropist. He built his home in a mansion called the San Suchi, which is today's Masina Hospital. And guess what? Bikla was also known for his religious harmony. You had Jews, Muslims, Sikhs, Christians, Hindus, all of them living here in harmony and a sense of community living. In fact, not so far from here is the Magen David Synagogue, which came up in the 1860s. Mumbai's Christian population is made of two sects, the Roman Catholics and the Protestants. The need for Protestant churches in Bombay increased when the British came to rule over these parts. One of the most prominent and earliest churches for the Protestant community is the St. Andrew's Church, which is opposite Lion Gate. Later on, some of the other popular churches that emerged was the Afghan Church in Colaba and the St. Thomas Cathedral inside Fort. In light of the church development program, the then governor of Bombay, Mountstuart Elphinstone, decided to build a church in Bikla, and that's how the Christ Church emerged. Plans were drawn in 1831, and the foundation stone was laid out by the Earl of Clare, the later governor of Bombay. In fact, Clare Road, which is right outside this church, has been named in honor of him. The church came up at the cost of ₹17,000. And finally, it was open for the public to attend Mass in August 1833. The governor decided to shift his residence to a country home in Parel, and hence the need was also felt that the governor needs a chapel of ease. So instead of going to attend Mass on Sunday all the way to St. Thomas in Fort, the governor of Bombay had a chapel of ease over here, and that's how Christ Church came into being. As you see the outer facade of the church, it reflects the true spirit of the neoclassical architectural style which was prevalent in those times. It is flanked by four Doric columns from base to ceiling, and there is a three-tier spire which goes all the way to the belfry, which houses the bell. Christchurch is one of the earliest and finest examples of neoclassical architecture. Buildings of similar vintage that you're going to find in Bombay include the Mint Building, St. Andrew's Church, which is opposite Lion Gate, as well as the Town Hall, which is at the Asiatic Society. In fact, the Magen David Synagogue, which is not so far from here, is also a neoclassical style architectural building. The neoclassical style of architecture is defined by certain elements: the grandiosity of its scale, Doric columns, as well as geometric designs, but in a very simple manner, and blank walls. The church's interiors are defined by its 12 fluted Doric columns, the stained glass panels, the Burma teakwood furniture, and the lath ceiling plaster. The staircase on which I'm standing on right now is as old as the church. In fact, Christ Church decided to undergo a restoration process that went on for 2 years. The first phase began in August 2015 and the second phase ended by December 2016. UNESCO was so happy with this entire conservation project that they gave them the Award of Merit in November 2017.
As the present trustees of Christ Church, we believe that it was our responsibility to retain this glorious church and the purpose for which it was built. I'm very happy to tell you that the restoration of this church has been done by one of the leading conservative architects, Mr. Vikas Dilawari. And in this process, we have tried to retain a lot of the existing material, and today this is one of the most beautiful churches in the city of Mumbai. A short example is that if you look at the cast iron structures that are in this church, they were brought in 1833, perhaps transported to this church by bullock cart, which would have taken 2 months to complete. And then to erect these structures, which are about 24 feet made of cast iron, the flooring that is seen is 200 years old almost. We haven't changed that. The pews that people sit on are basically the pews that existed from the time this church was built. So we have retained as much of the glory of this church, and we are sure that in the years to come, this church will be remembered for the grandness and for all that has been done.
Happy to be part of this team that helped in the conservation of the Christ Church over here. More so being an architect, I believe that such efforts in conserving religious structures goes a long way in understanding the heritage and the lineage that we have inherited as part of the community, and also happy to contribute to the community in giving back to society what has happened here.
According to stained glass conservationist Swati Chandgarkar, the functionality of stained glass panels and windows in churches is two-pronged. One is to increase a sense of biblical reverence within a church, and two is to cause a sense of awe and wonderment at the vibrant splash of colors. Vikas Dilawari, who was the conservation architect for this building, tells us that the stained glass panels that you see here are of the highest order and are on par of what you see inside the Rajabhai Tower and the Convocation Hall at Mumbai's University. What you see right now is the central panel inside the church, which is made of 3 panels. This was installed as a memorial to Spencer Compton, a trustee of the church who died in 1866. He was also the proto-notary to the Bombay High Court. The art that you see on these panels has floral and repetitive patterns, and it was installed in the 1870s. I'd like to share over here a word about John Scott, who designed these panels. Scott was born in Carlisle in Cumberland. His father and grandfather had a business and were manufacturers of stained glass. His work, in fact, has been exhibited in the Royal Academy from 1872 onwards. Now we move to the second panel, which is a singular one. This highly painted panel is dedicated to John Randall Greaves, who died in 1904. This can be spotted to the right side of the main altar. As you see, this panel shows biblical references of Jesus Christ and was installed in the early 1900s. The filigree work on the pulpit is a striking feature dating to the origins of the church. A similar style has been introduced in the front facade of the teak altar to create a sense of symmetry. You will also see influences of this at the communion rail as well. The memorials and plaques that you see on either side of the walls inside this church offer great insight into the life and times of the British who lived in Bombay. One of the most interesting plaques is that of Sir Robert Grant. Grant Road railway station has been named after him. In fact, several Bombay governors after him as well came to attend service over here. The Burma teakwood furniture that you see all around here is actually the original furniture. What's terrific about this restoration is that they use the services of local craftsmen and artisans to restore it and ensure its original character was intact. This is the lectern of the church. The lectern is the stand on which an important book is usually placed. And in cases of place of worship like a church, the Holy Bible is placed there. As you will notice, the shape of the lectern is in the form of a bird, the eagle, so to speak. In most Anglican churches, you will find an eagle as the symbol over here. The reason for this is that the eagle represents St. John the Evangelist. And St. John the Evangelist is known as the premier saint when it comes to sharing the word of God. And the word of God in this case is from the Holy Bible. We've reached the piercing resistance of this church. The 12 fluted Doric columns with Corinthian capitals. As you can see, there's been gilded work done to accentuate the details. These columns were shipped from England and were a gift to the church. There is a striking resemblance to the ones at Town Hall that were shipped for its grand assembly room. These columns have also been decorated, on which rests a teak wood beam. Come to the end of this walk, but I hope that along the way you would have realized that Christchurch, while it is a place of worship, is also a terrific celebration of architecture and the history of Bombay. I leave you with a thought that was shared to me by the late chronicler and the urban planner Kamu Iyer. He told me that a city can only be as great as its residents make it to be. Happy walking and happy exploring. Thank you.
subscribe to Midday India. Get direct notifications on all our videos by clicking on the bell icon.